Join me today on Dolphin Tales. I have Alex Boylan. Alex is a soccer alum, someone who is many things. He's a producer, he's a show host, he's a show creator. And so Alex, first of all, thanks for joining me on today's show.
Good to see you, my man. Thanks for having me.
This is
I saw Dove, you know, a few episodes podcast back. And so I have big shoes to fill here.
You do. Well, hopefully this will be a little bit easier to edit, like I was talking about beforehand. And you got dressed up with the collar, so we're already way ahead, which is great.
Yeah.
But yeah, Dove was great. It was a fun interview, and he did mention a little bit of how he got started because of you. So I'm sure we'll get into that. So first, I want to start where we are right now. And, you know, I think congrats, a big congrats are in order. You and I spoke before the taping and, you know, with the world's toughest race being the number one show on Amazon. So that's huge. Why don't you talk a little bit about it and just let people know who may not know about the show, what it is and what you guys are doing.
Okay, so the world's toughest race is probably the coolest thing on television right now. 66 teams of four people each from 30 different countries around the world go on a massive expedition. It's like an expedition with a stopwatch. And so, and it's a show that Mark Burnett created, Lisa Hennessy ran it, 17, 18 years ago. And it's the precursor to Survivor, right? Survivor kind of came out of that. They were doing that show first. And then they just brought it out of retirement, you know, 17 years ago. So we filmed this in Fiji last September, this time last year. And it just got released, you know, in the height of COVID over the spring, summer. And it's just been a massive hit. So it's, if you like true adventure, right, with stakes, but really nice human storytelling, because I always say that it's, why are these people? I mean, this is, people have to go use from mountain bikes, rappelling, you know, hiking, to every type of like, you know, way to get across 600 kilometers in the island of Fiji through jungle and some of the toughest terrain in the world. You'll love this. And at the end of the day, it's all about why. So you have some great heartfelt stories out there of people just, you know, ordinary people doing the extraordinary. And it's awesome.
Yeah. And so it takes place over, it's an 11-day race, correct?
Yeah. 11-day race. I always say, like, it's kind of a look at this like the Olympics, right? This is happening, right? And we are doing our best to have video, like, you know, cameras are everywhere, and then start putting that to tell a story. So it's a real event that we are capturing and turning that into episodic television for people to view.
That's awesome. Yeah, I mean, it seems like it was a really good timing. Obviously, I'm fortunate with what's going on in the world right now, but to give, you know, an audience that's stuck at home something that is outdoors, that's kind of hitting on all levels. Like you said, you've got people that are into outdoors and whatever it is, mountain biking, you know, supping, hiking, running, whatever. But then you've got the other side. So maybe if you're not into all of that stuff, it's the stories. And, you know, my wife and I are about halfway through it now. And that's what got us. It was like, you know, we do triathlons, we do outdoor stuff, but you're hearing these stories of like father and son teams and people that have been doing this since the beginning. And so it just hits you on all these different levels and it keeps you coming back. It's an incredible show.
Thank you. Yeah, I think it's very inspiring. I think it's very timely. Not only, you know, we've all been locked in our houses, but just we live in this world now of like, we're all behind our computers 24 hours a day. And so I think this shows like the human spirit out there on an adventure. And so, and when we see it, like, you know, this is something the whole family can watch, right? The whole family can sit down and you want to inspire your younger ones, right, to get outside and appreciate this amazing planet that we get to live on. Check out the show.
There you go. Yeah, it's you know, you see the teams, and like you said, there's people that are just ordinary people, and you've got the elite teams, and so it's one of those rare instances where you can have people like the average Joe out there competing with the best in the world. You know, it happens in Ironman and a few other places, but it's not like, you know, in the soccer world or the baseball world, you know, I can go pick up and go play with all-stars. It just doesn't happen. And that's what's really cool about this. And to see, you know, like a team made of four Ironman, like the Iron Cowboy, who did 50 and 50, you're like, oh, this guy's going to crush it. He's like a middle of the packer, you know? So it just shows like how real this thing is.
This is as real as it gets. This is like, I mean, this is raw. This is real. So what you're seeing, it's not like your standard, like, you know, let's vote somebody out. It's like anyone you know, can make it to the end, right? And so I think a good, so you nailed it on the head. I think a good, another good analogy to when you're watching this, and this, hope people don't get turned off by this, but it's like golf, right? Bear Grylls is this announcer and he's checking in with people. There's different gameplays happening. People are going through different struggles in different parts of the race course and different parts of Fiji. And so of course you have these super elite athletes that are competing to win this, but 99% of the people that are out there are not trying to win, right? They are just trying to survive, right? And you got to make it to these five camps. And there is a ticking clock. If you don't get there by a certain point, you would be eliminated. So it's either you don't make it there on time or one of your teammates quits, right? Or someone gets injured, which happens all the time. So it's really just survival. Like, you know, imagine you with your best friends out there and we are trying to survive this expedition. And from a storytelling perspective, Bear's checking in. All right, cool. We're checking in on this team right now. This is what's happening down there, right? We come back out. Here's what's happening with the elite teams and how that like race is unfolding. So there's many storylines happening at the same time, spread out over hundreds of miles. And for us, I think that's what we're, you know, I'm really proud of how the show came out, that the audience can track it, follow it. And that it's such a big hit because it is a mass. I mean, this is the biggest adventure show in the history of the world, both budget, crew members, and there's 700 crew, over 1,000 with the cast, spread out over hundreds of miles of terrain in some of the most brutal conditions on the planet. And so it's a pretty amazing show. I hope people get to check it out.
That's awesome. So why don't we talk a little bit about your involvement? First of all, how'd you get involved with this project? And then what were you actually doing on the show for, you know, obviously before, during the 11 days, and then afterward?
Yeah, absolutely. So Lisa Hennessy, who's the executive producer, showrunner, she's really like the general out there, like, you know, making this show, that she was making the show, as I mentioned, 17, 18 years ago with Mark Burnett. So she's still at the, you know, top of the food chain managing this. She's a good friend of mine. We ran Dream Jobbing together, multiple different shows. So she's a really good friend. She called and said, when the show is coming back, originally I was only going out there to be like what was called a content producer. So I was just going to go in the field for a month, have some fun filming in Fiji and kind of be like a team player wherever they needed me. But, and so that job probably was the best job in the world, at least for someone like me. I mean, literally I was given a driver, a bunch of camera equipment. I'm not a videographer, but any producer that's out there, most people, if you have a job out there, you're probably holding a camera at some point in time because there's just so much stuff happening. And think of it like military. So they would be, Alex, we need you at this checkpoint, hang out there. And I'd be hanging out there trying to capture a story with the video camera. And then all of a sudden, like, we're going to send a helicopter in and we're going to bring you over to this other part of the course. And so the most fascinating part is like, you are living with the Fijian. You don't have much. I mean, it's literally like, I got some camera stuff. I got a tent. I know what I need to go do, what I need to accomplish. And for example, I mean, I was checkpoint 29, which is where it's near the end of the course, where you're coming off a mountain bike, transitioning to the SUP into the ocean. I was sent there to just kind of like hold the fort down. These New Zealand racers, if you watch the show, there's certain teams that are like just crushing, cruising through this course. So like, get ahead here and try to grab this story. So I was planted there for like 4 or 5 days, like embedded with this village. I was like having kava ceremonies in them when I was shooting. But it was super cool. I would hire these local kids. So I was by myself prior to other crews being able to bring, you know, get support for me. And there I'm on my own for 24 hours a day trying to capture this stuff. And imagine that's happening all over the course. So this is just my personal story.
Right.
And so in order to find out where the teams were, I paid the kids $5 Fijian, which is like $2 in American, to hike up this hill, look down, and they could see teams. And if they could see a team, that'd give me about 45 minutes to get ready. So these kids, you know, became part of my, you know, helping me make the, you know, make do my job. So they would scout for teams, run back, like, Alex, team's coming. I was living in a, you know, in a hut, like right next to the checkpoint, sleeping next to 4 locals. I woke up one morning at 3 o'clock in the morning, woman's making bread next to my feet. And I was like, is this what you do every day? She's like, yeah. So you were like, I would go to this other house and she'd make me tea every morning in this other house and take a shower out of a bucket. And so I think that was what's amazing for the production crew. You were living with the people. I don't know exactly, but I believe the race course went through 100 or 200 villages that they all had to get approval for to make this thing happen. And so the Fijians, the people who are amazing, were very much a part of making the show. And so Unbelievable experience from my end. And, you know, it also showcased on TV. And then afterwards they said, Alex, will you come in and oversee a couple episodes? And that's really not my skill set. It's not like I'm usually, you know, running smaller shows, and I'm usually looking what we would call a rough cut, right? So I'm looking at the half hour episode when it's put together. And this is like, can you help with this? So I knew how exciting and how hard these jobs were to get, just because, I mean, it was, these were some of the best producers. Like I say, this is Mark Burnett, right? Bear Grylls, Amazon Prime. It just doesn't get any better. So I couldn't say, you know, no to that opportunity. And I was excited because I just spent time in the field. So I came back and oversaw episode 4 and episode 9, once again, with the most amazing team possible to make that show. It's not me. There's a huge team that's making that, but it's fascinating. I mean, imagine. So episode 4, that's day 4, right? That's how you split up the episodes, is each pretty much a day. So episode 4, I mean, you just have a bazillion cameras, right? So, I mean, I created this like Excel spreadsheet that was time of day at the top, cameras down below, and there's no way to figure this thing out except for watching it. So, I mean, fortunately there was the budget, but I mean, I spent weeks just watching footage, making notes, and then you start slowly, you know, putting the pieces together, because you're finding these like 30-second minute stories, and then seeing, you don't know, you might have the beginning of an awesome story, but you got no middle, you got no end, right? Because it never was captured. These people are really moving. So finding all these little pieces and trying to put them together for your episode so it makes sense, and you're tracking something, and then also, you know, tying that into the overall arc of the series. So I just can't say enough for the post team. And fortunately, I was working with, you know, the best of the best. I told people all the time, I would give like this section, let's say I found a story about the Kukri, you know, the twin sisters from India. I'd be like, oh, here's the story. And I'd give like an hour or so footage to these editors and be like, I think this is what the story is. Let's cut that down to 60 seconds. And like, I'd come back, you know, a day or two later with like the most unbelievable story, way better than I thought it was. So that's the type of people you're working with, which I think when you just bring that group together, magic can happen and show it in the show.
That's unbelievable. That's fantastic. Well, so let's talk a little bit about adventure racing, because I think you might know a little bit about it. So let's go after graduation, and then we'll go all the way back to how you got to JU. But why don't we talk a little bit about you and doing the Amazing Race? I think that's something that's pretty important in talking about your experience with racing and all that. So.
Yeah, I mean, that was, you know, two different shows, but that was the beginning of my career. I mean, I was an international business major at JU, went and worked in Germany, then worked in Boston, and figured out that that was not the thing for me. I was a market analyst up in Boston, sitting behind a computer. I'm way too hyper to be doing that. Quit that job and ended up moving down to St. John in the Virgin Islands. I'm giving you a little bit more of a backstory here, but that's great. It was, I'm living in St. John, taking a year off. I'm probably 22, 23, figuring out like that corporate world that I was working in is not for me. I have no idea what I'm going to do. So I've taken this year off. A buddy of mine was graduating from Clemson. Chris Lugo, who's one of my best friends with that, grew up in Boston, and he was on the Amazing Race with me. I picked him up from went to his graduation. We drove back to Boston. You know, now he's all excited to get into the, you know, the workforce. And I'm sitting there still like, I don't know what I'm going to do, because that world that I was just in is not for me. I'm not going to crunch numbers the rest of my life. Anyway, Survivor had come out that summer, right? So remember season 1 of Survivor? Mm-hmm. So that came out. That was the first time I ever watched television. So I was in. I was like, this is the coolest thing I've ever watched. It was real. So I was super excited about, you know, I was glued to the TV watching that show. So Chris and I are back in Georgetown, Massachusetts, where we grew up. And a pop-up came out on my computer, and it was like Race Around the World for $1 million. And so it was as simple as that. My sister and I was like, oh, this is awesome. The only thing you had to think about, because remember, this is the beginning of reality television, was Survivor and maybe Real World Road Rules on MTV. That's pretty much all you had. Yeah. And so old VHS camcorder, grabbed my little sister. I was like, we went out back. It was like pitch black out. I don't know what we're thinking. And just started recording, you know, Chris and I were just, hey, this is why we want to do the show. And fortunately, ironically, we were like backpacking through Europe. We still didn't, you know, a month or two later, and they got a hold, CBS got a hold of us and said, hey, we want to meet you. And went through the whole casting process, got on the show, won the show. And that was a big turning point for me in my journey in life, because when I was racing, of course I'm competitive and I want to win, but I couldn't stop talking to the producers. Like, I was like, so imagine, you got the context of where I'm coming from, right? So I don't know what I'm doing with my life. I definitely don't want to go back to this corporate world. Now I'm racing around the world and I'm meeting producers. They're all around me, right? This production's happening. You know, I think there's, you know, that's a fascinating show to unfold, right? To be part of.
Sure.
And so I couldn't stop talking to the producers. And I literally be like, okay, so wait a second. This is what you do for a job? Like, this is your job? Like, how do I do this? So it was weird. While I was racing, I literally, it was like a light bulb in my head. I knew 100%, like, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life. It was very clear to me. So I thank God every day for that opportunity, because it exposed me to a world that I never knew existed, right? Never was ever part of it. So I got on it, and, you know, I can take and do the next pieces of the puzzle. But that was a big turning point for me.
And I like how you just nonchalantly mentioned I was on it and won it.
Yeah.
Just like in passing, you know, no big deal. Just season one winner. No big deal. Okay.
Yeah. Season two, right? So season one. Yeah. Just, you know, it's funny because season one started airing after we're in the casting process.
Okay.
Chris and I, so now obviously the premiere of Amazing Race, we know at this point that like they're interested in us. It's not like we're on the show. So we're out on the TV to watch like the first episode, and CBS called that day. And they're like, hey, are you guys getting ready to watch The Amazing Race? We're like, yeah. And they're like, well, congratulations, you're on the second season. So we didn't know. We found out the episode one of Amazing Race is the day that we found out that we were going to be doing the second season. And it's, you know, it's, you know, it's like the biggest scavenger hunt in the world. And Chris and I, it was good, because I always said like the reason – I think the advantage we had, and if you look, they don't do a lot of like, you know, alpha male-ish ex-athletes on the show, right? The show's very different than what it was back in the day. And I can explain that if you want to know, but it was a different show. But we had a huge advantage just being athletes. I truly say it all the time, because Chris and I are just buddies. We played high school sports together. And we looked at this as a competition. So, of course, I'm going to mess up. Of course, he's going to mess up. We're going to make mistakes. We made more mistakes than any team out there. We could not have won the show. But we had that, like, I'm never going to give up until this thing's over. Like, for sure, that was, like, part of our DNA. So even when I messed up and Chris is like, you're a complete idiot, what is wrong with you? We might get fiery for a second, but it's over, right? And we'd butt back to, like, focusing on, like, what is our goal right now? What do we need to accomplish? And having that mentality is a huge advantage, because imagine couples, family members, whatever, feelings can be hurt. People get emotional. And as soon as your mind's out of the game, forget about it. As we know in sports, right? It's over, right? If you can beat them mentally, you beat them. And so Chris and I were never able to be like broken there. So I think every day was just like, just keep going, right? And so we were very fortunate to win that. And winning a show of that caliber, I mean, it was, you know, that early on, was a really big deal, right? I mean, Chris and I were getting noticed anywhere we went. We're on shows, you're on that stuff. So we were very fortunate to win when we did, because nowadays winning reality shows not like it was 20 years ago, you know?
Well, yeah, like you said, I mean, it's just there weren't that many. And so it was a new show, it was a new concept. And I remember hearing, you know, the whole story about you guys winning. I was like, oh yeah, I remember. Alex, yeah, sure. And that was one of the big things, of, you know, coming out of JU was like, okay, you know, and I think having, because at that time it was, you know, the old basketball teams, there was a few here and there, but like that was one of the big stories when I was going through, like, we've got the guys that won Amazing Race. That's pretty cool. So and it's, you talked about that mentality, and that's one thing we've touched on a few times in previous Dolphin Tales episodes, is, you know, transitioning from the, you know, the collegiate life, you know, so you go through, you're playing sports at whatever level, and then you end up becoming a D1 athlete, and taking those lessons, you know, the things that got you to that level, and transitioning to whatever it is you're going to do. So we've talked about it, you know, in the corporate world, and just, you know, how those things benefit you. And so on top of, you know, that mentality, what are some of the other things that maybe you took away from being a D1 athlete that have transitioned over, you know? So if I'm thinking about people that are listening now that are either incoming to the university or getting ready to, you know, be done with their playing career, knowing that there's something else on the horizon, what's another thing besides the mentality that, you know, you personally either took from it or see as a benefit?
Yeah, it's funny as you get older and you look back of like decisions you made or, you know, and I was playing soccer because I loved the sport, right? That was it. And I, you know, it was one of my reasons I picked JU is like I wanted to play D1 soccer and I wanted international business. And there weren't that many schools that offered both, right? And so I was almost a Gamecock, USC, College Charleston. But anyway, like JU had these two things that I really wanted. And that was a big reason why I chose the university at that time. And I always say, like, to me, the best decision I ever did was play sports at college because the structure I had at JU was awesome, right? So I had to go to study hall every day. I can't remember what time, 7, 8 o'clock. You had some tutors there, but they created this infrastructure where I'm not saying I would be messing up, but there's no room to mess up, right? So you're forced in this world where, of course, you got to get your classes done. And you better get your classes done because your coach is going to be upset with you if you're not passing grades or whatever, if you're not doing well. And then you're given the infrastructure. So I think it's like, you know, they always say, you know, if you want something done, ask someone who's busy, right? And it's true when you're a college athlete at JU, you're like, your day is pretty busy. Mm-hmm. And so I think that structure was super important for me then and carrying that with you through life. So, and then obviously I always say, you know, when hiring people, looking, you know, at people's resumes, being a collegiate athlete, is like something I definitely look at, like to have that competitive edge. Cause you understand that that person is not scared to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning and train, right? That person's not worried about like the amount of effort that we have to put in. And I'm not knocking the average student, but I'm just saying the amount of work and extra stuff that goes into, you know, being, you know, an athlete there is different. It just is, right? It's a lot more time that is going to be demanded from you. So I always look at those as that as a potential, you know, that's if you've accomplished that, that's a big thing. So yeah, JU, I mean, I you know, soccer was awesome. You know, we got to go to the Sweet 16. It was like an amazing team. Some of my best friends to this day. But I think because it was this smaller university, I don't know, there was a different feeling, different vibe to it. And I think the accountability, people knew who you were, right? And so I think that was really important.
Yeah. Hey, you're kind of on this. No, you did. And you're part of this kind of puzzle that somehow we're building here because we had Dove on. He's from up in Massachusetts. We had Hillary on. She's from the Boston area. Came down, track, you know, kind of all world. Now she's playing professional women's football back in Boston area. And so we've got you. And so I always like to hear, you know, because I came from Southwest Florida. And quite honestly, I didn't know Jacksonville University till my senior year. You know, I was looking at some bigger schools. I was looking up Northeast. And I actually went to another, I'm not going to say who, but another baseball camp. And, you know, they split us all up into teams. And my coach was one of the assistants at JU. And so he started talking about this university that's by the beach and, you know, telling me about the team. And I'm like, okay. And I happened to turn on and back then it was Sun Sports. You know, they're playing Florida State. And I'm like, okay, yeah, this could be all right. So I'm interested to know, you said you're looking at some other schools and obviously, you know, the program and the major that was available, but you know, what got you looking at Jacksonville in the first place?
So it's not tough to sell a kid from Boston, Florida beaches, right? So that's like a front area. But and that's legit. Like I went down on a recruiting trip to look at a number of schools. So I was looking at University of South Carolina, College of Charleston, JU. I'm trying to remember the other one. There was another one. But I came in the middle of February, right? And so and it was just awesome to me. So obviously you get to JU and you're like, it's 80 degrees and you know, you're not far from the beach. It's not that tough of a sell. Dennis Violet was the coach there before Alex Mihalovic. So Dennis was the one who I was talking to and was recruiting me. And so, you know, it's funny. Back then, you didn't have a lot to choose. You know, you think about like a college, and I'm actually working on a new project that will hopefully help this problem out there. But back in 95, which is when I was going to college, you know, you talk to your guidance counselor, you know, they pull up some pamphlets. Right. So I literally was like Division I soccer. I wasn't heavily recruited down in the South. Most everywhere I was getting recruited was up in New England. Okay. And I went to university. As soon as South Carolina started looking at me for soccer, that somehow, you know, translated into like helping me with getting, like working something out with JU. But Dennis Violet, you know, he was awesome. And I just remember getting to campus. You know, I think it's a feeling, right? When you're on trips kind of going around, because I wasn't down there on like an official recruiting trip. That was just me checking out schools. So I went down there ironically with Chris. We were bouncing around to a bunch of different schools. I just remember getting on JU and being like, this feels like home. And that was it. It was simple as that. It goes without saying, it's the people, I think, that just make JU awesome. I mean, like, they're my best friends to this day, right? Like, Dove and I, we talk almost every single day. And there's a number of other guys from the soccer team and not on the soccer team. They're my best friends. And so there's something about, because it's such a, I mean, think about it, it's one of the smallest D1 programs, I assume, in the country, right? And so, and it recruits a lot outside of Florida. So, I mean, one of my best friends, Dan Villarreal, who's the captain of our team, he was from, a lot of guys from Texas, you know, so something about the university did a good job of however it was connecting dots. So a lot of us were coming from somewhere else, right, coming in. And I think that that creates its own energy where it's, you're not like all from Jacksonville where everyone's right. Like, oh, these are my high school friends, these are my buddies. Everyone's like, you know, coming in from the UK or coming in from Boston. So you don't have anyone except for the people you meet. And so that creates a nice energy to it, if you think about it, right? It creates like a right. fun, like, just open, friendly vibe where very few people are actually from the city that you're going to college in. So
yeah.
I don't know many people. I think about it, like a lot, I knew a lot of schools where many friends went to the same school, like UMass. If you went to my high school to go to University of Massachusetts, you're going to know a ton of people, right? Just based on your high school or your area you grew up in. I didn't know anyone. And I don't know if I know anyone who knew anybody, right? Like, I don't know. Maybe baseball did a good job because the recruiting around there, baseball was big. I didn't know anybody who knew someone else outside of the university. And I think that creates a great environment for just being open and friendly and, I don't know, create a good vibe.
Yeah, we actually had Lauren Bishop on. She played soccer a little bit after you were there. She was around the time I was going through. And she talked about that, you know, coming in, not knowing anyone. I mean, I knew one guy on the team when I came in out of however many. And so you get here and it's just, you make quick friends. And it's that family atmosphere where it's like, we don't know each other, but we're all kind of in this together. And not just sports specific. Like you said, you know, you have your guys that were in soccer and outside of soccer, but you just form these bonds within the athletic department and it carries you through. And like you said, there's that accountability because you really can't mess up because you can't get kind of lost in the shuffle at JU. And then it just carries on and, you know, it's, you make lifelong friendships and connections. And, you know, that's part of what we're trying to do with this show is tell stories like your story and keep people networked up because there is that family, you know, aspect to this. And, you know, hopefully people see you and like, oh my gosh, I haven't seen Alex in, you know, 20 years. I need to call him. So that's the whole intent here.
I said that to you when we were chatting the other day. It's like, I'm so excited that you're doing this because JU needs to like do it better at like connecting dots afterwards. Like you should have Frank Pace on here, you know, because Frank's one of the biggest, like, you know, he did Suddenly Susan Foyle, a big time like sitcom producer, and he played soccer at JU, you know, and we're good friends out here. I mean, he's, I don't know exactly his age, but in his 60s.
Awesome. Yeah. Well, there you go. There's the next one. So,
yeah.
Well, Alex, really do appreciate it. I know we were talking beforehand and next time you're in Jacksonville, we'll bring you back on. I'm sure we'll have more stories, more projects. You've always got something going on. Really appreciate your time today and thank you for being on with us.
I appreciate it, man. Anytime. This is really fun.